when death declared his victory. The King of Love had given up his life. The darkest day in history. There on the cross they made for sinners. For every curse his blood atoned. One final breath and it was finished. Shake and the veil was torn. What sacrifice was made as the heavens roar?
All hail, King Jesus.
He is alive. Amen. The issue is who we celebrate. Amen. You know, as we were watching that video, we that enactment of different sins and hurts and pains and griefs being put on the cross, somewhere in that is ours as well. But not only did Jesus take those, he gave us the ability to exchange the shame, to exchange the pain, to exchange the grief. Amen? For his peace, his forgiveness, his righteousness in Jesus' name. I want to talk today about King Jesus. And while we celebrate our risen King, amen, a lot of things that we could think about when we think about Jesus, but Jesus, amen, he's crucified Lamb, yes, amen, but he's also Lord and Savior. Jesus also is our High Priest and King. And so we want to look at some things from the Word of God pertaining to him, because this is who we celebrate on this Resurrection Day, amen? Hallelujah. If you would, go to Matthew chapter 28, verse 6, and we'll just use that for a beginning place on today. Amen. And then we'll pray and we'll go into the Word of God. And we just ask you just to bear with us. Amen. And we're going to share a few scriptures with you, but in the end, we just want to magnify our risen Lord. Amen. You know, even if the world doesn't recognize in the way that they should, at some point they all will. The Bible tells us that every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Either we will bow our knee, amen, in this life and receive him as Lord, Savior, and King, or you will bow in eternity when he's your judge. But either way, all are going to acknowledge the lordship of Jesus Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. In Matthew 28, verse 1, it says, in the end of the Sabbath, when you're there, say amen. If anyone need a Bible, lift your hands. The ushers will get them to you. Amen. Glory to God. It says, in the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulchre. And behold, there was a great earthquake. For the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. My imagination could go a lot of ways from that. They said it would take several men to even push the stone, but this angel just rolls it away and sets on it. Verse 3, his countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the women, fear not, for behold, for I know that you seek Jesus Christ, which was. Somebody say, which was. Which was crucified. He is not here. He is not here, for he is risen. As he said, come see the place where the Lord lay. Let's pray. Father God, in Jesus' name, God, I pray in the name of Jesus that on this special day, God, as we honor you as our risen Savior, triumphant over death, hell, and the grave, God, as we honor you on this day, God, we ask you to open our hearts and minds, God, that you would speak distinctly to us, Lord. As we open your word, we pray that you open our hearts, that we might receive wisdom, understanding, and the ability, God, to apply your word to our individual lives. We take authority now over every principality and power, and any spirit that would seek to hinder, God, that your word would go forth and have free course in and among us in the mighty name of Jesus. So, God, we yield ourselves now to the ministry of the Holy Spirit and the Word of God. And for God, we give you the glory, the honor, the thanks, and the praise. For we pray in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. I want to call today, amen. Notice he said, he is not here, he is risen. Amen. I want to call our message today, celebrate our risen King. Amen. We see here that Jesus was not there. There was an empty tomb. There are some things I made note of that I want to share with you real quick pertaining to this, because, you know, today is what many call the end of Holy Week. And last week we preached from Matthew and several other books concerning the fact that the King is revealed. Today we want to call the King is risen. Amen. On Palm Sunday, Jesus came riding on a donkey, showing them that he was king. Amen. That he came among them in an humble way, as kings did, riding a donkey, not on a horse of war. And they waved palms before him. By midweek, they were shouting, "Crucify." Amen. And so Jesus died for our sins on Passover. But he was resurrected from the dead on the Feast of First Fruits. We taught about that. We won't today, but Jesus fulfilled every one of those feasts. He fulfilled three of the seven in his death, burial, and his resurrection. But when Jesus was on that cross for you and I, when they nailed him on the cross, there's another song that we sing that the lyrics sort of go like a few. I'm not singing, y'all, so I spare you that. But it says, "I never know how much it costs to see my sins upon that cross." Amen. We'll never know the awesome price. We can imagine. The Bible gives us insight into it. But our minds really can't wrap itself around the awesome price that Jesus paid, amen, to redeem you and I. Amen. This Lord Jesus that we celebrate on today, amen, that was resurrected from the dead, amen, is the central event, amen, concerning the most important man, the most important work, amen, the most important time in all of history, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's so important, Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15, that had he not been raised from the dead, amen, all your serving God is in vain. That you're without hope, amen. See, it's all because he was raised that you and I have a right to have new life, amen. And so we celebrate and honor what Jesus has done for you and I, amen. Hallelujah. And so we want to look at how significant is that resurrection of Jesus. Amen. How important is it? How significant is it? Amen. Well, the resurrection of Jesus is so significant that the world acknowledges, not just the body of Christ, but that the world historically acknowledges the resurrection of Jesus. Amen. Now, here it says that no man has impacted the world as Jesus has. You know, like him, serve him, amen, or despise him, amen, you're affected, bam, amen. Amen. Every major, our major holidays are either about or revolve about around Jesus, not just in the church, but in the world. That means that Christmas is an opportunity for us to exalt Christ. Amen. Resurrection, they say Easter, we say Resurrection Sunday. Amen. It's a time for us to exalt and point lost humanity toward Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Even Thanksgiving is about pulling aside just to give glory and thanks unto the Lord God for the provision he gave us as people and as a nation, amen. See, it's all about Jesus, amen. And behind all those celebrations, there stands the man, the Son of God, our risen King, Jesus Christ. Amen. That's what I get excited about, amen. Whether they want acknowledgement or not, they do in everything they do, somehow recognize Jesus for who he is, amen. Now they need to receive him, amen. Matter of fact, his message, amen, changed nations, didn't it? Amen. We are now called a Judeo-Christian nation because our precepts, our laws are founded on the laws of the Bible, amen. And so these are things that point back toward our risen King, our Lord and Savior, amen. Amen. Praise God. Because he was living and raised from the dead, amen, there's hope for those that are broken, amen. If you're bound, Jesus can set you free. Amen. Amen. Matter of fact, the risen Jesus is what connects the Jew and the Gentile. Amen. We say we should pray for the peace of Jerusalem. We prosper that love it. But also Genesis 12:3 says God would bless those that blessed Israel and curse those that did not. Why? Because our Jesus is a Jewish Savior. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Yeah, he's a Jew, amen, but he's the Savior of the world. All men, amen, need to come to Jesus to be saved, amen. Matter of fact, his message, the Sermon on the Mount, is called the highest and most exalted message that was ever preached concerning the issue of morality and how we should act, amen. It was in that sermon he said, "You are the light of the world." Amen. But it's also in that he talked about loving your enemies. Amen. Something entirely foreign to the world before Jesus came. Before Jesus came, our concept of charity and benevolence was not known as it is known today. Our concept of hospitals and caring for the sick and adopting orphanages all roll back to the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. in Rome where Jesus was, amen. You know, infanticide was common, amen. If you want a girl, they could just put you out and let you starve to death in the streets where the dogs could get you. But the Christians in the first century, they would come and take those children up and raise them in the knowledge and admonition of God, amen. That gave birth to our benevolent societies. See, all these things, we might not know the history, but they are all traced back, amen, to the church. Our hospitals, that originated from Christianity, amen. Amen. You know, you don't see that concept arriving from other religions and other sects. No. Why? Because we are commanded by our king to love one another. And so they would adopt the unwanted Roman children. They would bring them in. And eventually the whole culture was changed in Rome because of love. They wrote in their writings. There's something about this people. I was reading some of those old accounts. And they said that they don't bow their knee to Caesar. They only bow their knee to Jesus. Amen. And they'll die for the sake of Jesus. We don't understand this. Amen. All because of Jesus, the impact of that one life. There was a poem years ago called One Solitary Life. Everything has been impacted all around us by the life of Jesus. Amen. You know, history recognizes him as such. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. They can't deny him. Amen. They can't do anything about him. I looked at some of the writings of Roman writers, amen, like the reporters in our day, like Tertullian and Eusebius and Josephus. They weren't believers, but they said there's this sect, this people, they call themselves Christians because they serve the one that was raised from the dead. We never could find, they're writing this, we couldn't find this body, and these people, because of their devotion to him, they won't bow their knee to any other god but him. That was in their writings, amen. How significant is the resurrected Jesus, amen? Well, he's so significant then that whether society hates him or not, amen, our reckoning of time has to do with him, amen. When Jesus came, he split time, how we reckon time, into B.C., before Christ, and A.D., in the year of our Lord. Y'all know they're trying to change that now. They trying to say BCE, before the common era. No, it was before Christ, amen. They're trying to say ACE, after the common era. Well, what's the common thing? Jesus, amen. That's what they have in common, amen. It all revolves around Jesus, whether they try and take the emphasis off Jesus or not, amen. So we recognize him, amen. Everything in our world that is around us points back to the impact of this one man, Jesus Christ, amen. Hallelujah. He literally changed the world, amen. Even non-Christian religions expire, amen. New Agers say, man, he's the highest idea ever to have lived. Even Muslims say concerning Jesus that he was without sin and spotless, even though they don't believe that he was the Son of God. They can't deny his holiness, amen. They can't deny that he was a righteous man. They can't deny that he was a prophet of God. They can't deny, and they attest to it, that he was without sin. All opposition to religion resolves, comes down to this. Jesus said, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? Either he is the Christ, the exalted Lord, amen. Hallelujah. Who he is, isn't it? Amen. Well, we ought to praise him for it, amen. He is the Christ, the exalted Son of God, amen. And whether they like it or not, their knee at some point will bow. Amen. Some of the other false religions say that he is the highest example of humanity. He's the pinnacle of humanity. Well, we know him to be the great God and Savior, Titus 2:13, Jesus Christ, don't we? Amen. See, he has affected all of time and all of eternity because he chose to come and live among us, to die for us, to pay the price for us, and to be raised for us. See, this is why I celebrate. This is why we're to celebrate who Jesus is. Amen. His life is that significant. Amen. And lastly, amen, before I move on, of all the religions in the world, you know, they have a tomb for Buddha. Buddha lived and died and ain't buried. His tomb is right there. Muhammad lived and he died, and they know where he's buried. Jesus lived and he died. They know where he was buried, but ain't nobody there. Glory to God. Amen. The tomb is empty, glory to God, amen. He raised. He is not here. He has risen, amen. Look at your neighbor and tell neighbor, he has risen, amen. Hallelujah. And so because there's an empty tomb, amen, we know our Savior lives. Amen. And now we have the testimony that he lives in you and I, amen. Another great thing about the significance of him, he's able to indwell you and I, amen. And now we know him because he lives on the inside of us. Now for the message. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 6. If you're happy in Jesus, say amen. Amen. My job today is to put you in remembrance. Amen. But I wanted to show you just how impactful the life, the ministry of the Lord, our King Jesus. Amen. I'm getting so I love to call him King Jesus more and more. Amen. Amen. There's a YouTuber. Amen. Candace Owens. She got kicked off a podcast because the guy that she worked with didn't want Jesus to be called king. Amen. He's king. You know, whether people want to acknowledge him as king or not. Amen. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 6. And what we want to look at is a few things about this life. Amen. This most significant life. Paul is reminding the church here that if thou put the brethren in remembrance of these things, thou shalt be a good minister of Jesus Christ, nourished up in the words of faith and of good doctrine whereunto thou hast attained. Amen. Well, Pastor, I know about the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. Yeah, but God knows us. God knows that we let stuff slip. God knows that if we hear certain things so many times, they can become a little jaded to us. Amen. I don't know about you. I can't never get tired of hearing about our risen Christ. Amen. Amen. You know, even though it may pain me, man, he died and he paid an awesome price to redeem me. Amen. But I love to remember the why Jesus did what he did, because had he not done it, I would still be lost in sin. Amen. I'd still be an accident going somewhere to happen. Maybe you weren't one, but I was. Amen. I would still be a wretch undone, unchanged, except he had not intervened in my life to change me. Amen. And we need to remember these things. God is so, he knows so much about us that he knows that we have a tendency. Over and over, he reminds us not to let certain things slip. And see, if we don't keep certain things in remembrance, then we'll tend to take certain things for granted. One of the reasons why God gave the feast to the nation Israel, they were called the word Moed in the Hebrew. And when we see in Leviticus 23, where he talks about the feast of Israel, they were appointments. And they would enact over and over and over. What is God doing? He's putting the people in remembrance. Amen. He's doing it back then to point toward Christ. Amen. And so he said, on the 10th month the 10th day of the month of Nisan, take a lamb, bring it into your house, amen, and keep it until the 14th. And then on the 14th day, you would sacrifice it. And that blood would be sprinkled for the atonement of the sins of the people. That was called the Passover. And if you understand, if you saw, 10 Commandments was on last night, and that enactment of the Passover, when they put the blood on the doorpost and over the top of the door, the Bible says in Exodus 12, 13, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Where every year they went through that same process of acting out that scenario. Amen. That they were reminded, put in remembrance, you would say, every year that they needed something to cover their sins. The best they could get then was the offering of the blood of a lamb without spot or blemish. Amen. It could cover the sin, but Paul said their conscience wasn't clean. And so Jesus would come to be the Lamb of God to fulfill what they were practicing every year. Matter of fact, that's what our communion is to be. Amen. We are to remember that he shed his blood and offered his body for us, amen, so that we, the guilty, could go free and our sins are cleansed by not our works, but by the blood of Jesus. So there's strength in remembering. It builds us. It reestablishes us. It keeps us firmly rooted and grounded in what we believe. And so he's saying, put them in remembrance, that even as they celebrated Passover, Old Testament, that there will be a Lamb of God come, New Testament. John 1:29, Jesus said, behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. 1 Corinthians 5:7, verse the second part, part B says, even Christ our Passover is crucified for us. See, Jesus fulfilled the type. But there were several other days that were mentioned there as well. Amen. And we took time to go through those in Bible study. But this is part of why we remember why he came. Amen. Because he was crucified at Passover. And he was raised from the dead 3 days later at first fruits. We'll get into that in a minute. But why he came. And this is why Jesus came. Amen. He came to save sinners. Amen. Amen. You know, Paul said in 1 Timothy 1:16, Christ came to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Amen. So he came for you and I who were sinners. Well, Pastor, I'm a good person. Well, the Bible says there's none good, no, not one. You know, we can't work our way to get good enough for God to receive. Amen. We can't do enough philanthropy. Why? Because our sin is not based on what we've done. Being in sin is based on how you were born. Amen. And that's why 1 Corinthians 5:15-22 says that in Adam all die. In Christ all shall be made alive. You know, when God told Adam in Genesis 2:17 not to eat of the fruit of the tree in the midst of the garden, if you do, in the day you eat, you'll die. The penalty was death for disobedience. Well, Pastor, that had nothing to do with me. Well, you were in Adam, because all of us go back to Adam. Amen. And because we were in Adam, when he fell into sin, the sin nature passed to all men. So in Adam, we all die. Romans 5:12 says, for it's by one man. Somebody say one man. It says sin entered the world and then death by sin, so that death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. This is why you can't save yourself. You know, if you're here today and you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, amen, just saying I'm a nice person, I'm a good person, I treat people the best I can, I just hoping that I can make it in, amen, hoping and working won't do it. Why? Because you were born in sin. We all were. Not because of what we did, but our inheritance came through Adam. And so this is why you have to train kids to be good. There's a sin nature. You got to teach them to share. They think everybody's toys belong to them. Amen. What's that? That's the sin nature being manifest. We be laughing at the little kid and they go, no, no, no. Yeah, I remember. That's sin in operation. They'll manipulate you. They'll use you. Amen. They'll control you. Why? Because the sin nature is in us. Psalms 51:5 says, in sin did my mother conceive me. He didn't say that the act that conceives the child was sin, but the nature of sin is in us from conception. And so I can't do good enough. I can't be nice enough. We were hopeless and without God, but God sent Jesus. Amen. And that's the thing that excites us. We need to keep it in remembrance. Amen. Hallelujah. We got to remember that he came to be our sin sacrifice. When we couldn't do it, he came to sacrifice his life for us. A moment ago, I told you about the Passover, that the blood was shed. And God passes over our sin because of the blood. But the blood was shed so you and I could be redeemed and bought. Amen. Bought out of sin so that we could have new life in God. Amen. Hallelujah. And so I thank God for that. Amen. Jesus himself even said he came not to be ministered to, but to serve or minister and to give his life a ransom for any. Amen. See, we were stuck in prison and we couldn't make bail. Amen. There's a sin debt over all us that we could not pay. And so Jesus said in Matthew 20:28, that he would be the ransom for many as would receive them. To them gave he the power to become the sons of God, even those that believe on his name. Jesus paid the price, amen. And so when we couldn't work our way right, Jesus became a substitute for you and I, amen, to redeem us, to pay the debt, as it were, to get us out if we were to receive the free gift, free gift that he provided. You know, if you're writing scriptures, 1 Peter 1, verse 19. Amen. Says us that we are redeemed by the precious blood of Jesus. You know, there are churches that won't mention the blood of Christ today. There's some that's saying they won't mention resurrection of Jesus to get people in church today. Listen, if we're inviting folk to come to church on Resurrection Sunday, and we won't tell them about the resurrection and the blood of Jesus, that's bait and switch. I'm deceiving you to get you to come to church. No, we're going to preach Jesus Christ and him crucified, that he shed his precious blood on the cross at Calvary, amen, for my sins and your sins, amen, and that he was buried and raised again the third day so I could be justified, amen. That's why we celebrate him, amen. Amen. We remember that, don't we? Amen. And so we look back at what he did and we thank God that he did it for you and I. Amen. When people thought that I would never amount to anything, amen, praise God, I am what I am by the grace of God. Amen. You know, when it looked like our lives would never be anything of value, guess who valued us? Jesus. He loved us so much that he shed his precious blood for you and I. Amen. We need to remember that. We need to teach people that when they feel unloved, no, 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 God loves you. God loves you unconditionally. He loves you in spite of anything you've ever done. Amen. And we need to let them know that. Amen. In remembrance. That's why he said, put the brethren in remembrance of these things. Another thing we need to remember is that even though Jesus died for us, the means by which he chose to die, that old rugged cross. Amen. Now, some say the preaching of the cross is foolishness to those that perish. But those of us that are saved, it is the glory of God. Amen. Hallelujah. We cherish that old rugged cross. Amen. Hallelujah. Why? Because the cross was the means to the end. Jesus came to earth on a rescue mission. He said, I am come to seek and to save that which is lost. That was us. We were lost in sin. We were lost in trespasses. We had no way to get right with God. We were caught up some in idol worship all around the world at different times and places, trying to work a way to get right, but having no way until Jesus came. Amen. We need to remember, amen, that he came, amen, to die on the cross for you and I. Amen. And the cross is not just, amen, we see. And we look at now, you ain't noticed that we got some crosses up here, but ain't nobody hanging on them. Amen. He didn't stay on the cross, saints, amen. He came down, amen. Now, the reason the cross I called the means to the end, Jesus came to die for us. And the death that he died, probably up to this day, is still the most inhumane, the most degrading. You know, even when we have a prisoner on death row today, we don't strip them. We don't beat them before they inject them. Amen. This death was intended to degrade, so much so that the Romans would not crucify a Roman citizen. It was reserved for non-citizens, and then they would put you where you could be seen by all around you. And as they lashed you, as they humiliated you, the pain was so great that the term we use, excruciating pain, y'all know what that means? It means out of the cross. Amen. The most painful death imaginable for us. Amen. The cross is the means to the end of the death. That makes for you and I, as we saw the young lady earlier, writing down shame and writing down pain, writing down grief, writing down all those different things that we had been bound by and pinning them on the cross. That's literally what happened with our sins at Calvary. What people saw and what was happening was entirely different. They saw a man humiliated and hanging and dripping and bleeding, amen, painfully taking breaths, but in the spirit where God was, amen, my grief, my shame, my lie, my lust, our adultery, our fornication was being nailed on him. Amen. You know, they would hang over the cross, and we don't have it there, a little plaque that would normally say, this is why you're being crucified. Pilate didn't put that over Jesus. He said, King of the Jews in three languages. Why? Because he had no fault. He was testifying that there is no accusation against him. He's not a malefactor. He's not a robber. He's not a murderer. But he's dying the death of a murderer. And so he put on the cross who he was, the king. Somebody say king. He is the king of the Jews. And he's the king of all of us that are saved. Amen. And so there wasn't an accusation. Amen. Those things were nailed. Amen. And Jesus bore our sin on the cross. Amen. And so our transgressions were nailed on that cross. Amen. With Jesus. Amen. The cross was the means to the end to pay the price for your sins and man. Amen. Matter of fact, 2 Corinthians 5:21, one of my favorite verses, said that God had made him who knew no sin. See, Jesus never sinned. Amen. He never did anything wrong. He was a sinless, you know, he was qualified because he was without sin. Why? Because he didn't come through man. He was born by a miracle of the Holy Spirit. He was conceived in the womb of Mary. And so the sin nature wasn't in Jesus. And so Jesus then was qualified to die in my place to pay the price for my sin. I'm making it personal, but yours too. Amen. And so he's qualified to become the substitution, which makes the cross of Jesus, just like we saw that young lady, now a place of exchange. Amen. Because of the cross, we can get new life for old.
That's right.
Amen. Hallelujah. You know, we can exchange our old nature for a new nature. Amen. Who I was coming to the cross isn't who I am going away from it. Amen. Why? Because the cross is a place where I exchange who I was for who he desires me to be. Amen. When I receive him, I receive his righteousness. God had laid on him the iniquity of us all. And so when the Bible says God made him who knew no sin to become sin for us, it's so that we could be made the righteousness of God. Somebody say exchange. Amen. He took my unrighteousness, and then he makes me righteousness. That's to justify me. Amen. That's to treat me as if I had not sinned. Why? Jesus bore my sin. We need to remember that when we feel the weight of condemnation, because the Bible says there's therefore now no condemnation to those that are in Christ Jesus. Paul went on and says, who is he that condemneth you? It's not God. The one that's accusing you and slandering you, it's not him. From the cross, we receive forgiveness. Amen. So we need to remember this from time to time. Amen. Remember that exchange on the cross. Amen. Matter of fact, all us familiar with John 3:16, you know, we can quote it, that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him, I bet we could all go along and just quote it, shall not perish but have what? Sometimes we forget two verses before it. Amen. There was a time in, remember, the Old Testament is revealed in the New. So you need to read the Old. Amen. In Numbers chapter 21, verse 9, it was a strange situation going on there that the people, through their disobedience, God allowed fiery serpents to come in among them. And they were biting them and they were dying. And then God made a strange statement to Moses. He said, take a brazen serpent, a brass serpent. Brass in the Bible represents sin. He said, make a brazen serpent and put it up on a pole that whosoever would look up at that serpent on the pole, they would be healed. You know, no one knew what he was really talking about during that time until Jesus explained it. Amen. But if they would look in faith at that serpent, it took faith to look up at it, because in the natural, what's my looking up at a snake hanging up on a pole got to do with me getting healed of a poisonous snake bite? See, when it comes to the things of God, it always takes faith. If they didn't look, provision there was for their healing, but they had to look so they can live. Look at John chapter 1. Jesus explains that. You know, for a couple of thousand years, no one really knew what that meant. And so Jesus comes, John 3, verses 14. If you learn anything, say amen. And he begins to teach them. He says that, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. Amen. In other words, what is he saying? That whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world. See, we put it in his context. He's saying you need to look up. Jesus has become for you and I on the cross, the serpent on the pole. That simply meant that he who knew no sin became sin with our sin. And so God treated him as a sinner so you and I, the sinner, could go free at the cross, which meant that if Adam was given a death sentence, Jesus, who's called the last Adam, had to die, because God also is a just God. And so that meant that this sinless Son of God, Jesus, would die the death of a sinner in my place. Somebody say amen. Amen. We need to remember that. Amen. So at the cross, he suffered once for us, to just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the spirit, but quickened, made alive by the Spirit of God. Amen. I remember he suffered beyond imagination. Amen. And, you know, just the process, they would flog you before you were crucified. Well, that flogging process involved what they would call a flagellum. It was, some call it a cat o' nine tails. It was like a leather, you know, you would swing it, had like strips of bone and metal on it, and they would just rip the skin out of your back with it. You know, that didn't kill Jesus. Amen. But men would die from the flagellation. Jesus didn't, but it was designed to weaken you so when you got on the cross, you wouldn't live long. And so they beat him cruelly. Not because they could force it, but because he allowed them to. Remember, he told Pilate, right now, he could call for legions. Amen. See, he gave himself. They didn't take him. Throughout the whole process of being crucified, Jesus was still in control. He sat up because the priest said, not on the feast day, lest it cause an uproar. But Jesus said it so. He was crucified at 3 o'clock. Amen. He stayed on the cross from 9 until 3. And when the Passover was offered, he said, it is finished. Man, a God that's in control when everything around him is crumbling. Surely he can be in control what we face in this life. Amen. See, we need to remember that. Jesus is our pattern there. Amen. The sixth verse says, I gave my back to the smiters and my cheeks to them that plucked off the hair. And I hid not my face from their shame, from shame and spitting. Amen. You know, he was treated much worse than any man. Amen. In the 52nd chapter, amen. Wow, this is amazing when you begin to look at it. He said in verse 13, my servant shall deal prudently. He shall be exalted and extolled and be very high. As many were astonished at thee, his vision was so marred more than any man. The worst you could imagine, someone being disfigured, amen, beard plucked off, back ripped, you know, skin hanging all off, amen. Not because of anything he did, but for what we did. And Satan is unleashing all of his force through those Roman soldiers trying to destroy Jesus, and they couldn't kill him. It says here in verse 14, many were astonished at thee. His visage was marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of man. They said literally that means he didn't look human. They beat him so bad. Why is he doing that? You. Amen. He's doing it for you and I. Amen. He's paying the price for our sins and transgressions. The next verse says, so shall he sprinkle many nations with his blood. The king shall shut their mouths at him. For that which had not been told them shall they see. Amen. He did it for you and I. We need to put ourselves in remembrance. Amen. We should never take for granted the awesome price that Jesus paid to save my soul and yours. Amen. Hallelujah. And then we go to Isaiah 53, another account of what happened to the Lord Jesus. We're a little more familiar with this one, amen. Hallelujah. But, you know, they couldn't kill him, amen. Notice it tells us here two things, how men saw him and what God really saw. Amen. He is despised, verse 3, and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. We hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. That's what they thought about Jesus. But what God says, surely he had borne our griefs, amen, and carried our sorrows, our pains. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. God said he was bearing grief and sorrow and pain. They thought he was stricken of God and afflicted. God said he was wounded for our transgressions, for my breaking the law, for my land, my adulteries, all the stuff that we do, amen. He was bruised or pierced through for our iniquities, and the chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed, amen. Hallelujah. What does verse 6 say? All we like sheep have gone astray. See, that's how we were. Going our own way. But God had laid upon him the iniquity and the sin of us all. That's what was happening on the cross, amen. Our iniquity is being laid on Jesus, amen. It said he was oppressed. Verse 7, we won't read it for time's sake. But it said, as a lamb brought before the shearers, so he opened not his mouth. One word from Jesus would have put it to end. One word from Jesus and every wound on his back could have been healed. As they were mocking him on the cross, as Psalm 16 and 22 says, he could have just, all right, I'm over, done with y'all, I'm coming down. And he just could have popped the spikes out and you can't, but he stayed there. See, it wasn't the nails that kept him. It was his love for you and I that kept him on the cross. We need to be put in remembrance of that. The awesome price he paid so that you and I could have a right to the tree of life. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. He did it for us. Verse 10 says he made his soul an offering for sin. Amen. For you and I, so we could be born again in Jesus' name. Amen. As I say, remember, he gave his life. They couldn't take it. Amen. The bruises didn't kill Jesus. Amen. The stripes didn't kill Jesus. Amen. Literally, he said, my life is mine. I have the power to lay my life down, and I have the power to take my life up. Amen. The wounds couldn't kill him. Amen. When the price was paid, Jesus said, Telestai, it is finished. Paid in full. And then he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. He gave up his life. They couldn't take it. Amen. See, that's my king. Our king is not defeatable. Amen. He can't be overcome. Amen. His love for you and I kept him there. Amen. And so he gave up his life on the cross as my substitute. In those 6 hours, he bore the sin, the weight of it, of all humanity. So murderers could be forgiven. Amen. Transgressors, breakers of the law could be forgiven. Amen. So people that are committing indecent acts, they too can be forgiven, all because he paid the price on the cross. Amen. So that lets us know then that, you know, there's no sin too great. Amen. We said, man, you know, somebody like that, they could never be saved. Yes, they can. Amen. Hallelujah. Because he gave his life paying the price for all sin. See, we need to remember Hebrews 2:9 that Jesus tasted death for every man so that every man that calls on Jesus can be saved. So the people that seem the farthest away from getting right with God, they can be saved. So we need to let them know they can be. Amen. See, that's part of our work in the church is to let them know they can be saved. Amen. Hallelujah. Another reason why Jesus died on the cross as a means to an end was because the one that had the power of death was the one he was going to get after. Amen. Amen. Hebrews 2:14 says that through death, that he might destroy the one that had the power of death, that is the devil. See, all mankind was held under death's domain until Jesus came. Jesus undid his power. And he was raised from the dead at the resurrection, saying in Revelation 1:18, I am he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I'm alive forevermore. And I have the keys of hell and of death. Death defeated by Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Let me wrap this up. Amen. What the resurrection means to you and I. Remember, we are to put the brethren in remembrance. One thing the resurrection means for you and I, saints, that death is defeated. Amen. The angel said, he is not here. He is risen. Amen. There's a scripture in the Old Testament in Hosea chapter 13. Man, I never saw this, but we can find Jesus in every book of the Bible. In Hosea 13, notice what it says here. It says, I will ransom them from the power of the grave. Amen. In other words, Jesus defeated death, hell, and the grave for you and that. He said, I will redeem them, purchase them from death. And then he said, oh, death, I will be thy plague. I'll torment death. Amen. He said, again, I will be thy destruction to the grave, and repentance shall be hid from mine eyes. In other words, death was defeated when Jesus was raised from the dead. Amen. When the price was paid, God raised them up. Amen. And when Jesus was raised from the dead, amen. I said earlier, it was on the Feast of First Fruits. Well, the Jewish Feast of First Fruits was 3 days. Jesus said, I'll give you a sign. The sign of Jonah. 3 days and three nights that he would be in the belly of the earth. It wasn't Good Friday. We said Sunday, Good Friday was good because folk recognized it. But Jesus said 3 days and three nights he would be in the belly of the earth. And then he will raise according to the scriptures. Amen. On the third day at the Feast of First Fruits, when they will get the first of the barley harvest and put it in a sheaf and wave it before the Lord. Amen. Jesus was raised on that feast, and the Bible calls him the firstborn. Amen. The first fruits of many. Amen. It signified that there was a harvest to come. Jesus was the firstborn from the dead, the first fruits of his creatures, Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15. Now, if there's a first fruit, there's something following after that. It symbolized the harvest to come, which goes to another Jewish feast, Pentecost, the feast of the ingathering. Amen. But when there's a strange scripture, Matthew 27:53. Now, this ties into the first fruits. You might read there that when Jesus was raised from the dead, that the graves were open and people came out of their graves. Oh, we better read that. I never saw that before, Pastor. What's going on there? Amen. What's going on here, Pastor? It says, and they came out of the graves after his resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared unto many. What are they? They're part of the first fruits. They're saying that there's more to come. Amen. And you and I are part of the more to come. On the day of Pentecost, the church was born. And you and I are still to go out and reach the lost in the name of Jesus. Amen. We're still to go into the harvest fields. He said the fields are ripe, white, ready for the harvest. And so he assigned that to you and I. So this is part of what we do. But we remember he was raised. Time is not my friend, is it? Amen. He was raised for our justification so we could be right with God. You're blessed, say amen. 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 Romans 6:4 says, because he was raised, you and I can walk in a newness of life. You can have a new beginning in Jesus. He said, you don't have to turn over a new leaf. You don't have to wait till New Year to make a resolution. Resolution don't save, but you can determine to get right with God today. Amen. Hallelujah. And you too can walk in the newness of life. Amen. Let me close this by mentioning a few I ams, because when people talk about the I ams that Jesus said, we talk about the seven I ams in the Gospel of John. Well, there's more I ams than those seven. Amen. When you go to Revelation chapter 1, amen, still John the author, but he gives us a few more. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Amen. He is. That's the same. Now, that lets us know that Jesus Christ is Jehovah God in the Old Testament. He's God. God died for us. Our Creator died for you and I. The one that made all things, Jesus. That's who died for you. We weren't worth it. But he deemed us worthy. And out of his love, he died death in our place, the separation from God for you and I. He says, I am the Alpha. I'm the beginning and the end, the Omega, the beginning and the end. I am. But then there's a couple other I ams here. He says, and I love these. I am he that liveth, raised, but was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. And I have the keys of hell and the death, amen. That's the King we serve. He's living now forever, amen. He's not going to die again. One sacrifice, one time, forever paid for your sins, amen. We need to remember that. When we feel unloved, he loves me this much. He said, thou art graven on my hands. He still bears the marks of dying in our place. He said, handle me. Spirit had not flesh and blood, flesh and bone. Not blood, he shed it, as you see me have. He said, thrust your hand into my side. The Bible says the nation Israel will repent when they look on him whom they pierced. He still bears the marks. But don't feel bad. He bears the marks. I used to feel bad about that, and I heard someone, and this is where we close. Lady had a little girl, and she would go to school. And when mom would come to pick her up, people would always look at her and make snide comments about mom. And so she would come home in some days and weeping because people were making bad remarks about mom. And she didn't want them to see her. She wanted to keep her mom kind of put away because people looked at her, you know, in a certain way. But when she came of age, she told her, you know why I have these scars? Because when you were a baby, the house was on fire, and you were in it. And I went into the house, and I got you out. And she said from that point, those scars became something. It brought her to tears. She said, my mama loved me. She bears the scars of sacrificing, risking her life so that I could be alive today. That's how we look at the scars of Jesus, amen. He bears the scars because he loves me. And when we look back on him, we remember he loves us that much. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Give him a shout and a praise if you would in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen. You can let the screen down. I'm going to show you one little video. This is about 5 minutes. Amen. It's coming from what some call the greatest sermon ever preached. I can't do it. I'm going to let him do it. His name is C.M. Lockridge, and it's called That's My King. Amen. If you've seen it before, it'll bless you. If you haven't, it'll really bless you. Amen. But he is our king, isn't he? That brother could preach.
I wonder if you know him. Don't try to mislead me. Do you know my king? The Bible says he's a king of the Jews. He's a king of righteousness. He's a king of the ages. He's a king of heaven. He's a king of glory. He's a king of kings, and he is the Lord of lords. Now that's my king. Well, no barriers can hinder him from pouring out his blessing. No means of measure can define his limitless love. No far-seeing telescope can bring into visibility the coastline of his shoreless supply. Well, he's enduringly strong. He's eternally steadfast. He's immortally graceful. He's imperially powerful. And he's impartially merciful. That's my king. He's God's son. He's a sinner's savior. He's the centerpiece of civilization. He's unparalleled. He's unprecedented. He's preeminent. Well, he's the loftiest idea in literature. He's the fundamental doctrine of true theology. He's the miracle of the age. He's the superlative of everything good. He's the only one able to supply all of our needs simultaneously. He's available for the tempted and the tried. He sympathizes and he saves. He heals the sick. He cleanses the lepers. He forgives sinners. He delivers the captives. He defends the feeble. He blesses the young. He serves the unfortunate. He regards the aged. He rewards the diligent. And he beautifies the meek. Do you know him? Do you know my king? Well, my is a key of knowledge. He's a wellspring of wisdom. He's a doorway of deliverance. He's a gateway of glory. He's a pathway of peace. He's a roadway of righteousness. He's a highway of holiness. His promise is sure. His light is matchless. His goodness is limitless. His mercy is everlasting. His love never changes. His word is enough. His grace is sufficient. His reign is righteous. His yoke is easy and his burden is light. Do you know him? Well, he's incomprehensible. He's invincible. He's irresistible. I'm coming to tell you, the heavens of heaven cannot contain him, let alone a man explain him. You can't get him out of your mouth. You can't outlive him, and you can't live without him. Well, Pharisees couldn't stand him, but they found out they couldn't stop him. Pilate couldn't find any fault in him. The witnesses couldn't get their testimonies to agree. Herod couldn't kill him. Death couldn't handle him, and the grave couldn't hold him. That's my king. He always has been, and he always will be. I'm talking about he had no predecessor, and he'll have no successor. There was nobody before him, and there'll be nobody after him. You can't impeach him, and he's not going to resign. That's my king. Yeah. Do you know him? He's the master of the mighty. He's the captain of the conquerors. He's the head of the heroes. He's the leader of the legislators. He's the overseer of the overcomers. He's the governor of governors. He's the prince of princes. He's the king of kings. And he's the lord of lords. That's my king. Yeah.
God, hallelujah. Bless God, amen. Hallelujah. Every head bowed, every eye closed, amen. Hallelujah. Maybe it's someone here right now that you don't know him as king. You hadn't received him as Savior, hadn't received him as Lord. Amen. As musicians come, amen. You know, if God's dealing with your heart and you're going, Jesus, I need to know you. Amen. You know, this is a personal moment between each and every one of us. At some point in each of our lives, we had to make that choice. To bow our knee at the cross of Christ to receive him as our Lord and Savior. If you're here today and you said, Lord, today I need him to come into my heart, to be my Savior, would you raise your hand as an act of faith? You said, Jesus, I need to be saved. I need to make sure. I know now that you paid the price. And Lord, since you paid the price, since you died for me, I'll receive you. Amen, as my Lord and Savior. Is there anyone in Jesus' name? Maybe there's someone that maybe you drifted away from Jesus. And maybe the weight, the pressures, the pains, the hurts, the disappointments in life kind of cause you to kind of walk back on your commitment to him. But today you say, Lord God, I want to recommit my life to you. Is there anyone right now? Just raise your hand as an act of faith. That's just between you and God. You say, Lord God, I want to settle that issue. I need to be saved, or I need to get right with you. Amen. Is there anyone right now, as we extend that invitation, you need to get saved? No need to play around, amen, because you can't work your way to get right with God. We see plainly now that Jesus paid the price. Why die for sins that he paid for? Amen.